The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, through the humiliation of your Son, you raised up the fallen world. Grant to your faithful people, rescued from the peril of everlasting death, perpetual gladness and eternal joys. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Welcome to this podcast for the third Sunday of Easter, in which we will be looking at 1 John 3:1-7, as you can see on the board here. The gospel lesson is the appearance of Jesus to the 11 in the upper room in Luke's gospel, Luke 24:36-49, which is also part of the ascension gospel. So you may want to consider, in this year in which we have this as the Easter 3 gospel, to use the first part of it, just that, you know, the eating of the roasted fish and, you know, the disbelieving for joy and, you know, the appearance of his hands and his feet. But let's talk now a little bit about the gospel lesson from 1 John 3. And again, I commend to you the Concordia commentary on 1 John 1-3 by Bruce Schuchart, good colleague of mine from the St. Louis Seminary. He's done a wonderful job, and it's an extensive commentary on this text. So if you are actually preaching on this text, it's important to consult his commentary. I can see here that it's not 1 John 3:1-17, but 1-7. That's a typo. But anyway, he entitles this, "Because Even Now We Are His Children." And I highlighted some things here that I hope will be able to suggest to you some things that really do lend itself to being preached on. And I think it hopefully makes some comparisons to the gospel lesson for this day. First of all, I want you to see that we're going to have the language of love and hope. Here, hope. I should have probably put that in the dark green, but yeah, hope and righteousness. Those are going to be our key words. Righteousness comes a little further down here. If you look down below here, it's at the very end, righteousness here. So you see hope here and righteousness here. So those are some of the key concepts we have here. The theme here, I think, is that we are his beloved children. And this certainly keys off the famous, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." And we are his beloved children, you know, and he says that, and so we are. And I highlighted here in the yellow kind of the language, the ontological language of our status as his children, as his beloved. And he calls us that, tekna theou. And then again, at the very end, he calls us technia. Okay, so we are children, and we're beloved children. There's also another wonderful theme here, and that is the Holy Trinity. Here, I put it in blue, here is the Father. You can see down below here, that one who is pure is Jesus, that one. You know that one who has appeared in him. Here the auton also, and then that one. Now, even though Jesus isn't described by name, and Bruce Schuchart in his commentary, is in his translation, really highlights that. Where's the other one? Here. Kainos. It's kind of a connection between these two parts, and then a kainos down there, that one. You know, so you have the Father and you have the Son. And maybe the Spirit's here and I just don't remember seeing it, but I don't think it is. So that's the Trinitarian character of this, and I'm always looking for that. So you have love, you have hope, and you have righteousness, you have that triad. What you don't have here is faith, but I think you can bring that in from Luke 24. you know, where they're disbelieving for joy. It's a wonderful, wonderful statement, and I think I would pull that in. And of course, you have the Father and the Son here. So that's a very, I think, significant part of this text. And really, what you're seeing, and this is obviously by the Spirit, we're talking about who we are. We're talking about being. And our being is that we are loved, beloved. We are the beloved, and we are children. We are beloved children. Okay? So that's just a little overview. And now let's just look at some of the kind of the specifics here so you can see, you know, how this works. First of all, he starts with an imperative. See, and you know this statement very well, see what kind of love the Father has given to us in order that, purpose clause, in order that we might be called children of God, and we are. Now, if I were preaching on this text, this would be what I would preach on. This is the opening statement, and it's the fullest statement. Now, Bruce Schuchard says in his commentary that these verses conclude the first half of the body of the epistle, and many of the themes are being recapped, and I think that's a very important point. So you can see how this is, in a way, a summary statement. So on account of this, the fact that we are children of God, that the love of God that he has given to us, the world does not know us, and the world does not know him. I should have put this in blue, does not know him, okay? And there's the first reference to Jesus. The world does not know him. And you can see that our being, our ontology, who we are, our identity is in Christ, and it's reflected here by what the world does or does not know. And then he comes back and he greets them again, beloved now children of God, we are. You know, we are now beloved children of God. And we do not yet, you know what we shall be. It has not been made manifest to us, you know, what we will be, what it means now, the fullness of what it means to be in Christ. Now, I think he's looking forward here to what is really a great theme of Easter, and that is the future resurrection of the body. You know, that what will be revealed later on, you know. And what we will be has not yet been manifested, but this is what we know. This is what we know. And I think this is so important here to see how he continues to use the ontological language. But this is what we know. That when he is made manifest, I think that is when he comes again in his glory, we will be like him because we will see him just as he is. And I just finished preaching in chapel on 1 Corinthians 15, 50-58. And it was about the resurrection of the body. And one of the things that I talked about was how the proclamation, you know, of Easter is the empty tomb from the synoptics. He is not here, but he is risen. But that's not the sign of the resurrection. The sign of the resurrection is the resurrected body of Jesus. And that is what we will see when he appears again. We will see his resurrected body just as he is. And I made a connection there through the commentary of Greg Lockwood on 1 Corinthians, where the language of inheritance is used, is that we do, in a sense, see Jesus because we have received our inheritance, that is, our identity, who we are, because he is the testator of his last will and testament, in which he says, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. And we see him in the Eucharist. We see his very body and blood in the Eucharist. And that is how we see who we are in him. Anyway, I think there's one more verse in this little section. And I think it brings in a concept here. I'm going to erase some of this stuff that is really important here. And it's a word that I was not that familiar with. And you're going to see this is the beginning of the pasha. Pasha, there's all kinds of them. You see one down here? Pasha. But everyone who has this hope, namely what has gone before, that we are his beloved children, okay? Everyone who has this hope, in him, I should have put this in blue, I missed all these, in him, in Christ, what do they have if they have this hope in him, okay? That in him he makes pure, he makes himself pure, just as that one, Christ, is pure. Let me just translate that again. Now, everyone who has this hope in him makes himself pure, just as he himself, this that one, is pure. Now, this is a language for purity, which is a kind of words I'm not that familiar with. Katharizo is the one I'm familiar with, and there are places where they're used interchangeably, and according to Bruce Shuckard, they really are synonyms. But notice where we've moved from. We've moved from love to hope. And hope, of course, looks to the future of this when he's made manifest. And the way in which we kind of maintain ourselves until he comes again, where we will see him just as he is to make ourselves pure. And how do we make ourselves pure? Well, it is holding on to that hope that comes from his ongoing presence among us, because of the holiness, the pureness that we receive when we partake of him. And I think you can see built into this verse, verse 3, is the ongoing life of the church in the liturgy, in the gift that we receive in the presence of Christ, the pure and holy one who is present among us in the church. Now, let's just see how the transition is here, and maybe there isn't one. I think I took this from Nestle Allen. You know, pasha, 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 and then you have ha poion, okay? But everyone who has, everyone who does, you know, everyone who remains, the one who does. I mean, he's talking now about the beloved. He's talking about those who are in Christ and loved by him. And here, you know, he goes back to, I think, a part that is really important in terms of locating this in the world in which we live that does not know us because it does not know him. Everyone who lives, this is the Shuckard translation. We would maybe translate that does, but he translates it as live. Everyone who lives for the sake of sin, lives also for the sake of lawlessness. So here you can see how sin and lawlessness, anomia, this is lawlessness, it's that anomi, that kind of detachment from anything that is of value. Because sin is lawlessness, okay? Now this is what we are not. This is not our status as beloved children. Then he goes back to that language of knowing, verse 5. And you know that one who was made manifest, so that he would, and this is Johannine language, in order that he would take away sins. Here is the atonement. Now, if I said the first part is maybe the theme of the whole thing, here is where you preach the atonement. And here you can see, this is the first appearance. We were talking about the second appearance above, but in the first appearance, it is to atone for sin. And why is it that he is able to, you know, take away the sins? Because sin is not in him. Okay, he is the sinless one. Now, this is the great hope that we have, this reality. And this is why we are the beloved children of God. And so the conclusion, 6 and 7, and these now, I think, flow out of this profound statement on the atonement. No one, he puts this in the negative. I would put it in the positive. Everyone who abides in him is not for the sake of sin, does not, you know, live for sin. Everyone who is sinning Let me see, I want to get this right. And no one who lives for the sake of sin, everyone who lives for the sake of sin does not has not oh yeah, okay. Does not see him nor knows him. I should just go with my own translation and not Bruce's. Everyone who is defined by sin, just as those are the ones who are defined by their abiding in him. And this abiding language is baptismal language, and it's Eucharistic language. But those who live in sin, they have not seen him, nor do they know him. And I think the seeing here is not necessarily an eyewitness, but is one who does not partake of the gifts in which Christ is seen, and cannot know him in the sense of believe in him. They do not believe in him. Here's where, you know, it's not used in any kind of Gnostic way, but Luke uses it too. That to know him is to believe in him. So I think that's you've got the two different ways of life: those who abide in him and those who abide in sin. Okay, those who abide in him do not sin. Not that we're sinless like he is, but we live in purity. Here you come back up here. You live in this pure lives. So finally, children, and it's the planato, a very important sort of imperative. Children, let no one deceive you. And clearly people are. For the one who does righteousness is righteous. Now here's this incredible language of righteousness that, of course, righteousness comes through the atonement. This is where God makes right what has gone wrong. And the one who does righteousness, in other words, lives this purity, in this purity, in hope, waiting for him to come again. And why do they do that? Just as that one, here's that one again, is righteous. And you can see that clearly this goes back to the very beginning, that if you are defined by your status as his beloved children, the ones who have this identity as the children of God, and who have this because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, then you will live in that righteousness because your righteousness comes from the atonement where he made right what has gone wrong. So as we think about this text in terms of the gospel lesson for Sunday, where Jesus appears before his disciples, you can clearly see that what he's talking about here is the necessity for us to understand that we are now defined by our identity as those who have resurrected in him by baptism and faith, and that the proclamation of the resurrection continues today in us as we bear in our bodies, baptized, made pure, made holy, living righteously, living purely in him, bearing the fruits of the Spirit that flow from us, that the resurrection of Jesus is proclaimed through us and our witness to who we are now in Christ.